So I'm not the English speaker. This is the first time I do this presentation. I wanted to do it sitting down so I can peek at my notes, but not possible, so I do it anyway, standing up. It's not a problem. Just a short introduction. I do something about the quality in DevOps. Yeah, this agenda for this talk. So first, short introduction, and then I have some key questions I want to bring forward to you. And talk a little bit about the background of the customer and some, in my opinion, success factors of getting the quality in DevOps aligned. And some examples with tools. I'm a technical consultant, so I like to look at tools as well, but I notice more and more that the human part is also very important, if not more important than the tools. So some examples with tools. And I hope at the end of this talk, you will have some answers. Unfortunately, because it's only 20 minutes, no time for questions here, but I will be in the stage there. So if you have some questions, please come to me and I will try to answer them. Short introduction about myself. Eric de Graaf, maybe pronounce it like that in Italian, I don't know. I'm a consultant at Alten Netherlands. I do the IT part. We do test services. Short about me, a trainer, coach, and also consultant. And if you want to reach out, my LinkedIn and my email is there. So I started in IT at around 99, just before the millennium bug, and I started as a web developer. And later I rolled into system administration and then into test consultancy as a performance tester. And then later on when I joined Alten, I also became interested in functional test automation. And then the whole market became agile. I started more interested in CI, CD and DevOps technologies. So that is where we are now. Enough about me. Let's just start. These are the key questions. So I've reshuffled a little bit, but I'll explain. So the first question I have is actually answered at question four later, you will see. But how do you assure rapid software change process while maintaining customer satisfaction? And I hope to have answered that in the success factors. That's a slide I have. And also, what's the impact of DevOps in the way of working for the Agile team? Also, how does it change your testing, your manual testing, and your test automation? And what kind of organizational and technical changes are required to do the successful DevOps adoption and migration? So, customer, any idea what kind of business they are in? Flowers, yes. I think maybe the title also gave it away a little bit. But they're in the flower wholesale business. So I started in January. This January I started at the customer. And the customer was really, you can see it as a pragmatic customer. Meaning they roll up their sleeves and just do it. That's the nature of their business. So when I started there, you don't see stacks of paper. You just see people doing work. It's the type of customer they are. So if I look at other customers I know, for example, a bank or insurance company, they're all more formal than this one. So it was for me a culture change to look at this customer. So they want to improve. They want to improve the process. They know that by heart. How do we do it? So that was a challenge. So if you come home to your wife and you have flowers like this, she will not be happy. She will throw them away, probably. But the flowers, it's a very rapid business. So they're brought in and then the same day they must be shipped, cooled, distributed over the whole country, even abroad. So it's a very fast way of doing business. So the IT is also managed just like this. So very pragmatic, not a lot of documentation, just going for it. So to give you an example with this, if you come into a room and you see some water on the floor, yeah, we can bring a mop and you start mopping up the water, of course. And the next day you come in, there's again water on the floor. So, but if you would stop and just think, you'll see the waterline. It needs fixing. Okay. So this analogy goes the same with software and software testing and quality. If you would stop and think about how to improve it, you will, in a structured way, fix the problem. This is not a new concept. But for this customer, it was new. So they needed to stop and think and structure. So a driver for change for them, it was because of the nature of the business, the driver for change was not really that they needed to structure it, but they looked at the risks and they often would accept the risk. So they know that the vendor is making lots of changes, also changes for other customers on the same system, but they would accept the risk because of the nature of the business. And that is, of course, some sort of risk mitigation. From previous customers, I would say it's unacceptable maybe, but for them it worked. So that driver for change did not work for this customer. So we need to rethink the strategy. What did they do? They saw a bottleneck there. The bottleneck was they wanted to push forward changes. They did the CI, CD, and DevOps. So increasing the time, decreasing the time for a change to travel to production. That was, for them, a driver for change. So we started with that. The customer self, it started with the Agile transition. So an Agile coach was brought on board, helped them with the whole Agile and the way of working in Scrum. And after that, a DevOps coach was brought on board to help them with the technical changes. And they set up the whole pipeline. But then again, the testing part, there was still a problem, still a missing piece. Because the testers, as mentioned before, they were just testing and mopping up the water each day. So that's where I came in, and I showed them the Agile testing pyramid. Probably for people in test automation, it's very known. You can talk a lot about this one, but what I said to the customer, they're always focusing on the top part of the pyramid and always doing the testing in a manual way. Still, if you automate the manual testing, but still, it's very hard to automate the top part, like the GUI. It's harder than going below the GUI. So I talked to them and said, now, why not automate the stored procedures? And they said, oh, that's a good idea. Just proceed with that. And I did a small proof of concept. 3 days, I created, based on SpecFlow, created some simple demonstration for them, and it was very successful. Okay, so a little bit of mind shift there in terms of testing. Still this bottleneck, if you look at this, the testing part is still a huge bottleneck for them. So we really proved that it could be done with a simple set of tools and it could work. But still the culture was still there of mopping up the floor every day. And they thought of test automation like a one-stop solution, but it isn't. Test automation is a continuous activity. You really need to have the manual testing part. So not a one-stop manual testing process needs to be in place. So it needs to be standardized what kind of test cases, what kind of risks you take. So the structuring of activities was a very important part. So my role became like a test lead. So structuring of work, a way of working, and just helping them mature to the next level. And thinking about test automation as a solution, that's a misconcept. I think test automation is very good, don't get me wrong. I like to do stuff with automation myself. But first think about what you want to test and structure the way you test it. Risk-based approach, for example. And of course, with advancements come a new set of problems not yet discovered. Meaning, if you see the automation as the solution for the problems, it doesn't work. You need to focus on the core, get your testing process aligned, and then start looking at automation. That's the right thing to do. So what I've seen, I've been there maybe 4 or 5 months, What I've seen there is what is successful there in terms of DevOps. So, first, communication. Communication is key. It's also it's nothing new. I've really seen that communication helps a lot. And the structuring of work. Just getting test cases documented, the amount of test data you use, make it repeatable over and over again. And also a very important aspect I saw was the culture. The culture of DevOps, I see growth and learning and being able to experiment. So the small proof of concept I mentioned, 3 days investment, that's the culture, they allow that kind of experiments to proceed. You see it more and more. So if an experiment fails, it will be a small cost, but you have learned something. So that's the culture that will help for DevOps. And these three things look a lot like the three ways of DevOps. I don't know if you have read the book by Gene Kim. He mentions these three ways of DevOps. They're quite similar to what I've seen at the customer. So maybe coincidence, maybe not. Here are some examples I promised. So to answer the question, so how does DevOps change the way of working for an agile team? What it did is introduce a defect, an incident stand-up every day. So you have the development team as a regular stand-up for the agile way of working. And next to that, they have the incident stand-up. The incident stand-up, you have the ops guys coming in the room. What you do there is you discuss, what do you have to do today? Are there any incidents? If there are incidents, why? Why are they still open? Is it still an incident at this moment? And if you have fixed it, how have you fixed it? And constantly ask those questions. And doing that, you constantly evaluate the process of dev versus ops. And that's also touching the point of communication, of course. What I also see is that dev/test really needs to transfer knowledge to ops. So if you have the silo, so in the waterfall, in the previous type of working, dev test would create something, throw it over the wall, right? And then let ops deal with it. But no, in DevOps, you can do the training. You can train ops as well, because they need to support the feature. So they can maybe create a manual or update an existing one, provide release notes to your users. And also very important, just demo that's typically done in Agile, but also involve the ops guys, and also guide your key users very closely. Go to them and visit them and say, okay, we introduced a new feature. Well, this is the way it works. So just communication and sharing the knowledge. It's very, very effective. Question two. So how does it change the way of working for the testing team? The testing team needs to be more aware of operations. So what I've seen is that test a feature, okay, but how will it be used in practice? How will it work in operations? So tests can also be used for monitoring too. Ops has monitoring tools in place. Test the features. They also know all the conditions. They can provide information, tests, maybe a subset of that, to operations to include. And also saw that working. And also the short feedback loop from ops to dev test. So ops saw something and said, well, test, we have an issue. Why haven't you seen it? So the solution is like that. And then test looks in their scenarios if they have it and see if they need to add something or maybe update something. And here's an example of this monitoring. During on the left side, you see a query. So we're developing a database-driven system. And this query was used in a test scenario. And on the right side, you see the alerting tool of ops. So the tool could run these queries. And if you have certain hits, it was an alert. So test helped ops getting better monitoring. Question three. So what kind of organizational changes do you need? The software supplier themselves had an own development system. And the software supplier said, well, we do testing. Well, we looked at it thoroughly, and then they said, well, we do testing on our system. So a little more nuanced. And then we asked, okay, how do you do testing? Well, they said, well, we do it on our own system, and we think of the own data. So I said, no, before you release it, you need to test it in a realistic manner. That means we gave them access to our system, and to run a realistic test. So we shared our environment with the vendor, and then they could do better testing. Also, technical change automation. I come to that in example. So give the supplier access, share same post story, and no more manual changes to configurations. So what the developer, what the supplier did was they brought out a new version, and I had one guy was very knowledgeable, was a senior, did all types of tweaking, configuration, settings. We said, no, don't do that. We need to be repeatable. Don't do any manual configurations. It all need to be scripted. You see the VSTS from Microsoft gave them access, and it's all now done in the pipeline. So that means we can do a repeatable change process without any manual steps, but also decrease the time, of course, and the consistency. So, and the last one is also some example on how to answer that main question. So be transparent in what you want. It's very difficult to say, as a customer, I want this. Well, you can say I want this, but the one hearing that would have a different opinion and a different way of implementing what he wants. So write down the expected functionality with an example. And this is very effective in Agile teams. To give you an example, we use specification by example. It's a methodology, looks a lot like BDD, but the addition is you have more focus on those key examples. Well, I have another picture of that, but it's too technical probably, but we can talk about it later. So, but you see in the highline, the examples can become tests. Test, verify the requirements. So it's like a closed loop system. And what can you think about? Like this, this is an example. You see here the requirements are being written down and some key examples which tests all the edge cases. So for now, we can talk about it later. But for now, it's maybe too much detail. So to summarize, what have I learned? Be sensitive to the customer needs and culture. The one customer is not the other customer. Experiment and really foster that learning. Clear communication with all involved parties, meaning not only the testers, not the developers, but everyone in the house, the ops. To give you an example, the customer was at the floor where all the flowers get shipped. So if there's a bug in the system and the guy scanning the code would not work, then we come upstairs and steam in his ears and say, ah, it doesn't work. So that's really, in my opinion, really DevOps, because you're really touching the operation side. And dev tests can really provide valuable input to ops. And the other way around, ops can provide good feedback loops, quick feedbacks to dev tests. That was my presentation. Thank you.